Conservative Christian, right-wing Republican, straight white American male. Gay bashing, black fearing, war fighting, tree killing, regional leaders of sales. Frat housing, cake tapping, shirt tucking, back slapping, haters of hippies like me. Tree hugging, peace loving, pot smoking, porn watching, lazy ass hippies like me.
All right, that song may not be entirely fair. But today we're going to talk about Christian nationalism, which is not actually very accurately described in that song. But we're going to do this with one of the people who really knows it best, and that is Brad Onishi, co-host of the Straight White American Jesus podcast. That's why I thought about this song, actually. And author of Preparing for War, The Extremist History of White Christian Nationalism and What Comes Next. Brad Onishi, welcome to our show.
Fantastic to be here, and... song may not be totally fair, but it is on subject. That's
it's,
for sure.
It's not way off. So I think one of the things we have to do is, of course, try to unpack this term, Christian nationalism. What does it exactly mean? And I think the way to do it maybe is through specifics and then kind of widen out from there. So I'm going to play a clip for you. This is from fairly early in the Trump administration. At the time, Jeff Sessions is the attorney general. I bet you even know what's coming right now. But Jeff Sessions is the attorney general. The separation of children from their families at the border is emerging as a very specific policy of the Trump administration. A lot of people are asking questions about whether that's any kind of a recognizably American value is at play there. Here, A1 Maestro, is how Sessions answers that question.
I would say, due to the Apostle Paul and his clear and wise command in Romans 13, to obey the laws of the government, because God has ordained the government for his purposes. Orderly and lawful processes are good in themselves. Consistent, fair application of law is in itself a good and moral thing, and that protects the weak. It protects the lawful.
So there's a lot of that few sentences that you can agree with, Brad. But, I mean, beginning an explanation of White House policy with a scriptural citation just seems it seems sort of not the way we understand maybe the First Amendment and Jefferson's letter to the Danbury Baptists and all that stuff.
Well, it certainly is goes against the tried and true American ideal of separation of church and state, and the idea that we have a government that is free from religion and therefore provides the freedom of religion to all who practice, because the government is not going to get involved. Nonetheless, what Sessions articulates there is something that's only grown more popular as time has gone on, and that is the idea that there really should not be a separation of church and state. And in fact, the founders did not believe that there would be a separation of church and state. We hear this from Sessions back then, but we hear it now from anyone from Lauren Boebert to Marjorie Taylor Greene to any number of speakers at the NatCon conference in July of this year. One of the things that I think is most dangerous about that kind of rhetoric coming from Sessions and others is that they're basically saying that the government's laws are rooted in a divine law, and that if you go against the government, you're somehow going against God. And so this would make things such as the civil rights movement, the sanctuary movement of the 1980s that housed refugees in the name of God, any number of protests or civil disobedience as not only breaking the law, but as ungodly. And this is, in fact, what many right-wing Christian pastors claimed when Martin Luther King Jr. was marching, was leading sit-ins, was with thousands of others crossing the Selma Bridge. They were saying, you're not a real Christian because you're not obeying the law. So there's a dangerous precedent here that not only in American history, but of course, going all the way back to the European wars of religion and medieval Christendom, where the king and God were coincided, such that to disobey one was to disobey both.
So lest, we're going to go to B1 Maestro, but lest anyone doubt what you just said, here in fact is Lauren Boebert in Colorado in 2022. B1.
The church is supposed to direct the government. The government is not supposed to direct the church. That is not how our founding fathers intended it. And I'm tired of this separation of church and state junk. That's not in the Constitution. It was in a stinking letter, and it means nothing like what they say it does.
The stinking letter, by the way, I referred to earlier. It's Jefferson's letter to the Danbury Baptist. But yeah, you know, I feel like one change that I've noticed is that the number of people who would admit to being, to self-identify as a Christian nationalist, I think was used to be lower. It used to be a thing where if somebody said you were a Christian nationalist, you responded that you weren't. But you can even look at this very specifically with somebody like Al Mohler, who's the president of the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary. Right after January 6th, he was kind of objecting to the idea of the Christian evangelicals had anything to do with that particular event, but also he was referring to Christian nationalism as idolatrous. In a matter of just a space of a few years, he changed his tack on that. He said, we have the left routinely speaking of me and others as Christian nationalists, as if we're supposed to be running from that. I'm not about to run from that. And as we know, Marjorie Taylor Greene said, I'm being attacked by the godless left because I said I'm a proud Christian nationalist. So am I right about this, that this is kind of out of the closet in a way that it didn't used to be?
You are right. And I think what's happened is scholars and journalists and others have called attention to this phenomenon that is being labeled Christian nationalism. And there was a decision made on the part of folks like Al Mohler and Marjorie Taylor Greene to, instead of fight that label, to say, sure, if you want to call me somebody who loves God and loves America a Christian nationalist, well, then go ahead, buddy. I accept. And what happens there is something that is a very slippery rhetorical move, because they're wanting to convince anyone who's listening that Christian nationalism is nothing but a Christian person who loves America. What's wrong with that? And in fact, the charge that I would say is that Christian nationalism at its core is not about a person of faith who loves their country. It's about a person who thinks that because they have faith in a certain God, they get more of the country than anyone else. And so the rhetorical move has been made. Oh, sure, call me a Christian nationalist. I didn't know it was against the law to love God and love my homeland. And I would say that's a dishonest rendering of Christian nationalism. And it's not what me and others talk about when we talk about this phenomenon.
Yeah, we'll get into that a little bit more here. But I mean, I think it's also worth noting, it's a little bit more complicated. It's one thing for Lauren Boebert or Marjorie Taylor Greene, who are relatively small, hyper-specific, possibly gerrymandered constituencies. But when you're running for national office, it's a slightly different equation. Although it turns out not all that different. I mean, one of the other kind of watershed events, and this is quite recent, is that J.D. Vance joined, or at least appeared on the stage as part of something called the Courage Tour, which was organized by a person named Lance Wallnau, who you know a lot about, but I think most of our listeners have never heard of. He's up on stage. J.D. Vance is up on stage, not with Wallnau. But first of all, let's just say who this guy is. He's, among other things, responsible for what's called the Seven Mountains Mandate. This is one of the kind of tropes of Christian nationalism. So say a little bit about Wallnau and about also Seven Mountains.
Lance Wallnau may be the most influential Christian Trumpist in terms of leadership in the country today. And I know that many folks listening are going to say, well, I've never heard of this guy. Who is he? He's somebody that was at the right-hand side of Doug Mastriano when he ran for governor in PA. He's somebody that has toured the country and swing states. But he reaches millions and millions of Americans every week through his various ministries and channels. And he did popularize something called the Seven Mountain Mandate. And the idea behind the Seven Mountain Mandate is that there are seven sectors of human society: arts and entertainment, family, government, business, education, and so on. So you've got these seven mountains. And as a Christian person, your divine calling is not to persuade or negotiate in those sectors. It's not that you go into the education sector and try to win people over to the Christian viewpoint. You're called to dominion over those aspects of society. Each Christian is going to enter a different sector and have their influence in one of those, whether it's government or family or business. But here's the key point from Wallnau that has gone far and wide across Christian America. The goal is domination. The goal is control. The goal is for Christians to be at the top of every mountain and dictate how society runs in every facet. So when Wallnau shows up this past weekend with J.D. Vance at the Courage Tour, or J.D. Vance, I should say, shows up at Wallnau's Courage Tour, it's not a surprise to me, because the Trump campaign for a long time has been tapped into the folks that Wallnau has influence over, and they understand that he is a key to getting really important swing votes, whether it's in Pennsylvania or Arizona or elsewhere. I'll just say one more thing is that Walnow is not a Catholic. He's not even a kind of what we might think of as a buttoned up traditional evangelical, somebody who is in the Falwell family or the Graham family or who stood next to Ronald Reagan in 1980 or something. He comes from the independent charismatic world. That means if you go to a Walnow revival tour stop, you're going to see people speaking in tongues, rolling on the ground, healings, prophecies, and so on. It's a form of Protestantism that was often overlooked by politicians, but the Trump campaign has zeroed in on as a key demographic to winning the White House back.
Yeah, and because of that, because of what you just described, because in fact Pentecostalism, charismatic Christianity, kind of expresses a not mediated role between the believer and God. In other words, the Holy Spirit is directly coming into the person. They tend to be a little less measured in some of the things that they say. Here is Walnow talking about Kamala Harris. This is, by the way, I've now listened to a bunch of Walnow. This is not Walnow on a cranky day. This is how he talks about Harris all the time. This is A2, Maestro.
I saw Kamala Harris as being the one that the devil was going to use to push through the White House. And that I saw that early on. And I actually had a vision, which I thought was a warning from the Lord, of her at an inauguration. And she had a Bible, and she had done something like put a Hindu prayer book with it. And it was like she did an inauguration and was putting her hand on a modified Bible as part of her. And the Lord told me back then, he said that that is how the devil intends to bring in the destruction of this country. It's the final phase.
I mean, on other occasions, Brad, he talks about the fact that when he sort of is picturing talking to Kamala Harris, he's talking to a demon. Kamala Harris isn't even there. There's a demon inside Kamala Harris. But it's also interesting that he says Hindu at a certain point, too, because he's obviously kicking intentionally a tripwire there about Harris that would be unavailable with a lot of other more, you know, sort of some old-fashioned Democratic candidates.
I think there's, yeah, two things that are really important to point out with this clip. One is Walnow and others in his cosmos, what we call the New Apostolic Reformation, those who proclaim that they are apostles on earth and that they hear directly from God and have apostolic authority like St. Paul or St. Peter. So the New Apostolic Reformation is a kind of whole movement of Christian Protestantism in the United States. But one of the key components of this manifestation of Christianity is spiritual warfare. It's the belief that Christians, in order to dominate those seven mountains of society, have to enter society with a warfare mindset. They need to cast out demons. They need to pray for the strongholds of Satan to be cast out and for God to have control. So spiritual warfare language is rife anytime you hear Walnow or anyone like him. In addition, the Hinduism that you zeroed in on there is an easy target because Hinduism is, of course, not an Abrahamic religion. It's not a monotheistic religion. It's a polytheistic religion, and it's coded as something un-American, right? It's not something that the Walnow's audience is going to ever understand to be something American as Christianity or even the Judaism that some of these Christian folks are willing to accept and integrate at times. In their minds, this is something wholly other when it comes to ethnic and religious dimensions. And so it's a very easy code word.
So I want to go from there. So we should say Vance goes to this event and it's in Pennsylvania, and he's kind of careful not to be on stage with Walnow. He's on with sort of tamer people, although he does at one point evoke some of that kind of thinking. He talks about how the federal government is seeking to destroy churches and their place in their communities. He says it's a disgrace. Let's hope we can take this country back and make our country better. And one way that you get people into the kind of warrior mindset that you were describing before, Brad, is you tell them that somebody's already at war with them. And that seems to be a big part of that rhetoric I just cited.
It really is. So I just want to you point out that there used to be, you know, rhetoric that we would get that said, hey, let's make this a Christian country again by going out and convincing our neighbors that they should return to God. And don't get me wrong, that's Christian nationalist language, whatever. But it was a mode of engaging that said, hey, we're going to have to persuade people. We're going to have to pray for people. We're going to have to negotiate where they're at and see if we can win them over to seeing Jesus as the way to live their life. This is not that. This is a mindset of war, that when we go into the public square, we need to overpower people. And if anyone stands in our way, whether that be Hindus or Muslims or atheists, whether that be people who don't agree with us, we will see them as demon possessed and held by Satan. And we will have to do everything we can by brute spiritual force to overcome all of that. And so that kind of mindset is the exact mindset that dominates this manifestation of Christianity.
Yeah, and I think it's also important because it's one of the reasons that Christian nationalism is a little bit slippery to pin down and quantify and stuff like that is because these meanings are a little bit different from group to group, from person to person. You know, when Pew Research looks at this, 45% of respondents say, answer the question, do you think the U.S. should be a Christian nation? 45% say yes to 51 saying no. But then you ask them questions like, should Supreme Court justices bring their own religious views into how they decide major cases? 83% say no. Should churches and other houses of worship endorse political candidates? 77% say no. And, you know, it kind of runs like that, Brad. There's this idea, should it be a Christian nation? Sure, a lot of us think that. Apparently, 45% of us, but not the way that Walnow and some of the other Christian nationalists are trying to enact that.
I think the should this be a Christian nation question is really open ended. So if somebody said yes to that, I might say, well, what do you mean? And they say, well, I think we should be a nation that is a Christian nation in the sense that we don't lie. That's in the Ten Commandments, and we don't steal. That's in the Ten Commandments, and we don't murder. So, hey, I think if we had some of those values, we'd have a better place to live for our kids and so on and so forth. All right. I mean, you can see somebody answering that way when it comes to should this be a Christian nation. There's other data out there from PRRI from just last year that shows us that, you know, somewhere around a quarter to 30% of Americans think that the federal government should declare this a Christian nation. So now we're into something different, right? Now we're into like the federal government should proclaim this as a Christian nation. Some of that data says, in the sort of 20 to 25% range that Christians should have dominion over all aspects of society. Okay, so that's different than a Christian nation where people don't lie, steal, or kill. Now we're talking about Christians having dominion, dominating society over all others. Well, so now we're getting into a Christian nationalism that feels like it's an imposition rather than a certain open-ended idea of, you know, key religious values that most people could agree on, don't lie, kill, or steal.
We're going to take a quick break here. I want to talk a little bit about the history of this movement. Some of the stuff that I learned about the history of this movement really, really surprised me, and I thought I knew a lot about this topic. Brad Onishi will come back with us right after this break. I had so much fun picking out music for this show. Brad Onishi is a co-host of the Straight White American Jesus podcast and the author of Preparing for War, The Extremist History of White Christian Nationalism and What Comes Next. So, Brad, I went into a big rabbit hole with your podcast, and I want to talk a little bit about the evolution of this. And it happens I think in a way that's a little bit different than I lived through the evolution of this. I'm really old. And so I'm aware of the fact that, I experienced the fact that in the 70s and 80s, you start to see the emergence of something. And the something is going to take the form. It's going to have names like the moral majority or the Christian coalition. A lot of terms like family values are going to get slung around. And the person who really pushes the rock and gets it rolling either up or downhill, depending on your perspective, is a guy named Paul Weyrich. And Paul Weyrich does things like he founds the Heritage Foundation. So when we get to Project 2025, there's Paul's fingerprints on the rock. I think he coins the phrase moral majority. Mm-hmm. And interestingly, Brad, he's a Catholic, and he's a Catholic who's disaffected by Vatican II. That somehow is the thing that gets him initially into this space. But educate people a little bit more about this, about what's going on here.
Paul Weyrich's from small town Wisconsin, and he cut his teeth. Yes, that's right. And politically, he was a young kid in his early 20s and was campaigning for Barry Goldwater. And, you know, I think that campaign really taught him some things. It taught him that, as Goldwater said, extremism and radicalism and a non-negotiating stance is the way to do politics. About a decade later, he started to found right-wing institutions that he thought would make real lasting change in D.C. and across the country. So he does found the Heritage Foundation. He does found ALEC, the state-level policy machine. He has a hand with several others in founding the Council for National Policy and so on and so forth. He does all of this as a very right-wing reactionary Catholic who saw his church as pulling out of politics as it should have been done when Vatican II happened. So Vatican II in the Catholic Church is this moment when the church becomes more inviting, less imposing. It does away with the ideas of theocracy in Christendom. It recognizes that there are other Christian denominations and even other religious faiths. It understands all human beings to have the imago Dei, and thus, even if they're not Christian, perhaps to have some of the wisdom or insight that leads one to God. This is a drastic change in the Catholic Church, and he sees it as the exact wrong thing. So his mission is then to insert what he thinks is the right kind of Catholic morality into American government and politics, because the church will no longer do the job. So he, as a layman, will have to take up the mantle. Well, he's an ingenious institution builder, and he does something that almost no one had ever done in the history of the United States, and that is build a lasting and powerful coalition between right-wing Protestants and Catholics. Yeah. And that coalition is with us today as a very powerful force.
This is huge. I mean, prior to that, Catholics and Protestants were often like cats and dogs. And Weyrich says, to some of them anyway, you know what? You might be cats and dogs, but you walk on all fours and people pet you and you have to wait for people to feed you. So you got a lot in common here. And there's a lot of common cause we can make. But there's some other things that are going on too. And one of them, I think, has something to do with race, the civil rights movement, integration. And we should say that, and I think this is in Chelsea Evans' book, that one of Weyrich's early moves is he tries to get a priest fired for having an ecumenical service after the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr. Because it's ecumenical and we don't like ecumenical. That's a Vatican II kind of thing. But I think it's also Martin Luther King. And it seems as though, as he kind of, there's a chicken egg question, Brad. He seems to kind of go issue shopping among conservatives. Like, how do I find an issue that really is the high test fuel I can inject into this idea? And I think he trial balloons a few things, but ultimately it does seem like it's integration, it's civil rights. You can get the Jesse Helms and the Strom Thurmonds. You've got the Bob Jones University case from the Supreme Court that says you can lose your tax exempt status if you're segregated. So say a little bit more. First of all, do I have this right? Is that what Weyrich ultimately decides, as opposed to something more obviously religious, like marriage or whatever? Say a little bit about this.
Yeah, there really is this this interesting history here. So Randall Balmer, who's a distinguished professor at Dartmouth and is a couple decades older than me, you know, he tells the story of how he was actually in the room with Weyrich and many of the luminaries of the religious right. And Weyrich said out loud that he had tried to go shopping for an issue that would get the conservative Protestants to kind of get going politically. And the thing that really was the fire starter, so to speak, was the fact that the government was going to no longer allow these church adjacent schools, schools that were connected to churches to be whites only, that the segregation academies, as they were known, would no longer have tax exempt status related to their churches because they were violating, right, civil rights laws and so on. This was a motivator for many white Christians to say, not we should repent from our racism and actually not have whites only schools, but that the government is now attacking old fashioned Christian values. It's attacking the traditional family. It's attacking those who love country and love God. So we are ready to stand up and fight. Now, that fire starter led to what we now understand as kind of the family values movement or the family values ethos that still pervades conservative Christian politics today. So anytime you sort of attack folks and say, well, I can't believe you have these views, they will say, look, I'm just protecting the traditional nuclear family, which is the bedrock of American society. When I'm, you know, protesting queer rights in 1977 with Anita Bryant, or if I'm saying that women should not have equal pay and I'm not for the ERA, it's not because I don't want women to be respected or that, you know, gay folks or whatever. I'm just saying this is an attack on me and my understanding of family and my Christian faith. So we get the fire starter through race that eventually leads us to the family values ideas of marriage and gender, sexuality, and the big one that is on everyone's mind, abortion.
Yeah, and meanwhile, you know, I mean, I'm fascinated by the Catholic-Protestant fusion here because the public-facing part of this movement, for the most part, is the people whose names you've already called out. It's Pat Robertson, it's Jerry Falwell, it's Tim LaHaye. These are all Protestants, you know, certainly Billy Graham's son, I think, probably qualifies. Franklin Graham probably qualifies as a Christian nationalist, even if Billy maybe didn't.
Oh, yeah.
But then you think about that Supreme Court decision, the Bob Jones decision, and you think about the Supreme Court now. You think about the way that Weyrich kind of passed the baton of that to Leonard Leo. And we now have a Supreme Court that is packed very specifically with very conservative Catholic jurists. And that's no accident, nor is it entirely detached from the Protestant side of this.
I think one of the things that I've tried to get across in my recent work with the help of great scholars like Chelsea Eben and others is that, you know, when we think of the 70s and 80s that you mentioned, the moral majority, the religious right, we often think of Protestant preachers, Jerry Falwell, the Grahams, Tim LaHaye, Pat Robertson, Ralph Reed. And for deep and wide historical reasons in this country, we often think of Protestantism as the brand name of American religion. And over the last 50, 60 years, it's been really evangelical Protestantism as the brand name of American religion. What you're hinting at is that behind the scenes, working networks of funders, political operatives, those holding elected positions, not in perhaps the White House, but in state solicitor general roles, state legislature roles, and of course, now the Supreme Court, there has been an overwhelmingly influential Catholic movement that is really leading the way on these issues. And Leonard Leo and the Supreme Court are the prime example. Another example of this is the new widespread condemnation of IVF. IVF is an issue that evangelical Christians have not had an issue with for a long, long time and has never been a core thing for the evangelical at the mega church in the suburbs. Well, now it is. And that's all because of like long-standing Catholic theological tenets surrounding IVF and fetal personhood and so on and so forth. But it's a signal that the Catholic forces in this movement are really the ones leading the way when it comes to policy, when it comes to the direction of reproductive rights and contraception and everything related to gender, sexuality, and family. The cues are coming from the Catholics, and the Southern Baptists and others are really following their lead.
So, you know, in 1980, there were three candidates for president, each of whom claimed with varying amounts of persuasiveness to be born-again Christians. This would be Jimmy Carter, very persuasive. Ronald Reagan, you know, and John Anderson, I think also probably a born-again Christian. Nobody remembers him anyway. But you couldn't vote for somebody who wasn't a born-again Christian. But, you know, so Reagan is kind of going to be the guy. And then I think, you know, by the end of those 8 years, the Weyrich people are looking at him, and Nancy's got an astrologer, and he wasn't really a church-going guy. He's really not what they're looking for. So they keep looking. Eventually, they get W., who is really persuasively, I think, an evangelical Christian, if not a Christian nationalist. And but so, you know, they get a little bit more of stuff that they like, but not exactly. It's still Goldilocks problem. And then they find somebody who's just right. Implausibly, it is a person who's been married three times and accused of all kinds of other sexual depredations and is just absolutely just the personification of greed and worshiping graven images. He comes down a gold escalator. He seems to be the embodiment of mammon. But somehow or other, Trump is like kind of the guy. And before you attempt to address that, let's go back to our friend Lance Wallnau, because he at least has a one explanation. Here's him talking on CBS's The Takeout last month. A3.
I caught that idea in 2015 when I first met Trump. I met him up at Trump Towers. And at that time, I ran across Isaiah 45, and I said, oh my gosh, this guy is like the character Cyrus in the Bible, in that he's a deliverer who God raises up prophetically. Isaiah's prophesying a future deliverer named Cyrus. And he's not even Jewish. And I said, this is going to really... And I wrote this in a book. I said, Trump derangement will happen, because I used the term before it was popularized. And I said, because this guy has a Cyrus quality that I believe means that he's an outsider. Even evangelicals are going to have a problem with him, because he's not going to come in as Ted Cruz, or as Mike Huckabee, or as Ben Carson, or even a good Catholic like Marco Rubio. He's going to come in as a guy from Queens on his third marriage. And oddly enough, Isaiah 45 describes somebody who is an outsider who emerges as a deliverer for God's people.
You see what he did there, 45? But anyway, yeah, Brad, give me your take on all this.
Yeah, there's so much to say here. So I would say first that let's go back to the historical touchstones you mentioned. Ronald Reagan was also divorced. Ronald Reagan was somebody who had been pro-abortion when governor of California. Ronald Reagan didn't have a great relationship with his older kids. So all that family value stuff, not sure. And as you say, his Christian language really came late to the game. And yet he was chosen over Jimmy Carter, who was a Southern Baptist for life from birth. He had married his childhood sweetheart, joined the military, not to mention the fact that he was born in Plains, Georgia, a rural southern outpost that only recently had a traffic light installed. You would think that Jimmy Carter was made in the lab for the white conservative Christian to vote for, and yet they chose the Hollywood, California governor who was pro-abortion and on his second marriage. That portends choosing power over piety. It portends choosing somebody that promises you access and power rather than someone who has the same kind of religiosity and faith that you do. In addition, you mentioned George W. Bush. And I think what happens after George W. Bush is actually really important, because by the time we get to the end of W.'s time, the country in 2008 is more diverse. It is less Christian. It is less religious. And all kinds of signs in culture that the quote-unquote family values that Paul Weyrich and Jerry Falwell fought for are not going to be the dominant way of doing American media and film and television. Gay folks are on TV now. Ellen is out of the closet. We have Will and Grace as one of the most popular shows. And so when W's finished as an evangelical president, he didn't scratch the itch. He didn't fix it. And then we got Barack Obama, who's made in a lab to scare the white conservative Christian. He is biracial. His father is black. His father is from the African continent. His father is an immigrant. He grows up in that far off land that many are not sure is actually really America, called Hawaii, where my family comes from. It doesn't feel like the heartland. It doesn't feel like he grew up as, quote, one of us. And Barack Obama is proof to that conservative Christian that the country has really lost its way.
And let's not forget, one of his first stumbling blocks during the campaign is that his pastor is saying some stuff. Jeremiah Walker, was that his name?
Jeremiah Wright.
Right, I'm sorry. Saying some stuff, exactly the kind of stuff that certain kinds of white folks would find super scary.
And so what you have with Obama is proof that we need something different. It's not enough, as Wallnau just said, and going back to Wallnau's comments, to have a Christian president. We need a president who will protect Christians. We don't need a Christian president. We need a president who will do the damage Christians need done to destroy their enemies and hurt those who oppose them. So when Donald Trump appears on the scene in 2016, he's fulfilling everything that appetite was longing for. Was he a pious man? No. Was he a holy man? No. But did he promise to hurt the people that needed to be hurt in order to set the country back in order? He sure did. Did he seem like the one that had no qualms about viciousness and ruthlessness in the name of holiness? Nah, no problem. So he's our guy, not Rubio, not Huckabee, who's always telling dad jokes and being corny, not Ben Carson, who could barely stay awake during a debate. No, give me the guy who will brutalize our enemies so that we can have a country that looks like it's supposed to be, and going back to Lance Wall now, so that we can dominate every aspect of society.
Meanwhile, we have to do this part really fast because we're short on time, and I needed 2 hours with you, Brad, and I only have one. But they also have, suddenly, as the Speaker of the House, somebody who absolutely pretty much ticks every box for Christian nationalism. Mike Johnson is, I think, allied with the NAR. He's got that flag, that banner of heaven and Florida flag outside of his office. He talks in Seven Mountains language. He uses words like conquer. He says all of the things that a Christian nationalist would say. And, you know, he's close in the line of succession to being president, and Speaker of the House is no small potatoes either. In a way, a lot of little pegs are being hammered into place. Supreme Court, Speaker of the House, now you need to secure the White House again.
I think that's right. And I think it's worth just hanging out on Mike Johnson for a second. Mike Johnson emerges as a representative from Louisiana. He is, up until he becomes Speaker, really a backbencher. He's not somebody who makes a lot of noise. He's not really in front of the cameras very often, not on the news shows. And yet, behind the scenes, Mike Johnson is working with all of the tried and true conservative Christian networks that Paul Weyrich helped to build in order to overturn the 2020 election. He might have done more than any person in Congress to try to get the election overturned in the courts. He is also, as you mentioned, directly connected to the New Apostolic Reformation and people in that set of circles. So the pastors that he's very close to, he's invited to Washington, D.C., is Timothy Carcaden. Timothy Carcaden is in the inner circle of a man named Dutch Sheets. Dutch Sheets is kind of on the level of Lance Wall now in terms of apostles in this New Apostolic Reformation world. And that's why, as my colleague and I wrote back in November, it's not surprising that he has an Appeal to Heaven flag literally hanging outside of his office, because Mike Johnson is a true believer. You know, I think when Kevin McCarthy, his predecessor, got up in the morning, his prayer was something like, God, help Kevin McCarthy do good today, because Kevin McCarthy is really important. I think Kevin McCarthy thinks a lot about Kevin McCarthy doing important things and being in front of the camera. When Mike Johnson wakes up in the morning, I think he's like, how are we going to dominate the earth for God? How are we going to colonize earth for God? And so he's a true believer. And if the chips are down in this election in about a month, I am very confident of how he's going to act, because I know what he goes to bed believing at night.
Yeah, I'm pretty confident saying that Kevin McCarthy on a daily basis asks God to get an airport named after him. all right, let's take a little break. We're going to come back. We've got so much more to talk about. And as usual, our technical producer today is the maestro Dylan Reyes. Our senior producer is Lily Tyson. She is the producer of this episode. Tyson, I think it sounded like Tyson the way I said it. It's because I'm excited. This is a big topic for me. So we are talking today to Brad Onishi, co-host of the Straight White American Jesus podcast, author of Preparing for War, The Extremist History of White Christian Nationalism, and What Comes Next. I think we just have to pause. We don't want to make this too much of the focus of this final segment, but you come to this subject not simply as an inquisitive academic. You've lived parts of this. Just say a little bit about your background.
Sure. I converted at an evangelical megachurch when I was 14, came from a non-religious home, but soon church became my second home. Was a minister by 18, was a full-time minister by 20, married my high school sweetheart after my second year at a Christian college, and stayed in that world until my early 20s when I went to graduate school. This is not something that is a thing I study from the outside. It's something I lived, and it's something I gave, in essence, everything I had as a young person. So all of this is pretty familiar from a personal standpoint.
I want to talk a little bit, unfortunately, I want to talk a little bit about the connection between some of these ideas and violence. I mean, it's sort of in there with the idea of conquering, of dominion, of being a Christian soldier. It's there. And it's not new. I recently read Jeffrey Toobin's book on Timothy McVeigh and the Oklahoma City bombing, was reminded of his connections to the Elohim community, which I think pretty much qualifies as a Christian nationalist, but almost kind of separatist nationalist group. So this idea that these concepts of a Christian nation can inspire violence aren't entirely new, but they really kind of show up in a very, very naked way on January 6th as the U.S. Capitol is attacked by a mob. And a lot of that mob, Brad, they're, once again, they've got some of the flags we were talking about. It's the connection is pretty clear. It's not a stretch.
It's not. And so almost as soon as the riot happened, started to take place and the violence was underway, religion scholars and journalists started collecting under various hashtags, the artifacts and symbols and flags that they were seeing. And what has come out of that are several studies and exhibits that really show that January 6th was saturated with Christian imagery. The Christian flag, the Appeal to Heaven flag, militia members wearing patches with various verses from the Psalms sewn on their jackets, people carrying icons of Mary, statues of Jesus, and of course, folks stopping to pray and to sing songs of worship and praise. So, you know, for a lot of us, January 6th was really a story not only of stopping the steal, but of retaking America for God. And I think a lot of the people there were able to legitimate their actions by way of a story that said, I'm not here as a trespasser or an interloper. I'm here as a godly warrior. And if God is on my side and I'm with all of these people, certainly I can't be doing wrong. And I have a permission structure to proceed to do things that many of us around the country think were unimaginable before they happened.
Yeah, even Jacob Chansley, the so-called QAnon shaman, he was the guy with the buffalo headdress with the horns. When he gets into the hall of the house, he says a prayer, and it's very clearly a Christian nationalist prayer. It kind of just evokes so many of the tropes that are part of Christian nationalism. The other thing I'm kind of wondering about, though, is... And I don't know how familiar you are with this, but you seem to be familiar with everything, so I don't hesitate. You know, there's a term that's kind of come up recently called conspirituality, and it's about how some of these groups that we associate with conservatism and Christian conservatism and the new right, but the far, far new right, they kind of meet around the dark side of the moon with a bunch of sort of Naomi Wolf, Mark Crispin Miller kind of people who maybe met on adjoining yoga mats, that there's a way of sort of that kind of new agey questioning of authority finds some kindred spirits unexpectedly in the Christian right. And you're nodding furiously, so I'm not driving towards a blind spot.
Not at all. This is a phenomenon that is many people are studying, because you are seeing folks that are supposed to be quote-unquote liberal or on the left hand of the political spectrum. People, like as you mentioned, that go to yoga, perhaps participate in alternative spiritualities or medicines, folks who are part of wellness communities. You see them partaking in conspiracy theories that share a lot of resonances with conservative Christians. So in a weird way, we now have the yoga moms hanging out with the Sunday school moms, and it's not something many people expected. However, what I would say is that, the questioning of authority you mentioned is a real key. If you're questioning the authority structures of our society, that could be the government, that could be science, that could be medicine, and you're looking for alternatives, well, you might meet up with folks who are also looking for alternatives and folks you didn't expect to see, that being a yoga mom meeting up with a Sunday school mom. In addition, I think both of these cultures sometimes succumb to the belief that if they can just find the right healer, the right divine figure, the right president, that they will solve all the problems, that there's a desire for solution. And if you're seeking that kind of like final resolution to yourself and your community, it's easy to fall into the trap of the cult leader, the conspiracist, or the demagogue. And so to me, this is a surprising phenomenon that I think catch a lot of folks off guard. But when you dig into the mechanics, it does make sense.
So Brad, we have 3.5 minutes left to redeem Christianity. I think we can do it in 3.5 minutes. No, I look at all this and it makes me very sad. And I think it makes you sad too. I went to college. I went to Yale when William Sloan Coffin was preaching at Bethel Chapel. That's how old I am. But I mean, a few years ago, I was worshiping with a very, very progressive evangelical congregation here, probably the most LGBT-friendly evangelical congregation in America. And I got a lot out of it, you know? And it's sad that, I mean, conservative churches are also losing membership. Overall religious participation is going down. You mentioned the PRRI stuff. But I still think religion has an important place in American public life, just not the place we've been talking about.
You know, I spent a lot of time in churches. I spend a lot of time in churches, whether they're in Omaha or whether they're in San Francisco, talking to folks about these issues. And I never want it to be confusing. I don't think that Christian nationalism is equivalent to Christianity. And I do think there are so many instances where Christianity, in addition to other religious traditions, play a pro-social role in a democratic society like ours. They provide folks with community and with a sense of belonging and identity. They provide a sense of transcendence and a sense of a story that is still unfolding. With that said, it doesn't mean that religious traditions, including Christianity, don't often succumb to the temptations of power, of mammon, of influence, and of domination. And so I guess for me, it's always key to say that I have so many friends and so many colleagues doing great work in the Christian community, but we should never be afraid to call out those who are using Christianity as a cudgel for political domination.
Yeah, I mean, to me, the value of participation in Christianity, or really kind of any organized religion, has more to do with questions, right? It's like, what does it mean to be alive? What does it mean to be a person? What is this existence we're in? What would be good actions? What would be bad actions? These are all questions, though. And it seems to me that what's been substituted for some of that questioning, the kind of Thomas Merton stuff that might have been inspiring to me as a young man, are answers, and answers that are calls to action of a very, very very prescriptive and proscriptive kind. And that's, I think, where your scholarship, your work kind of begins.
Well, one of the things I've often said is that I became a person of faith when I left evangelicalism. And, some folks laugh at that. But what I tell them is, like, my religious community and my religious education were based on certainty. We have the answers. Now let's go act on them. And that's a different attitude than many forms of Christianity, much less many forms of religiosity, that, as you just said perfectly, begin with questions and seeking, begin with unknowing and a desire to sort of live in that unknowing and that uncertainty, and to ask questions that are fundamental to the human condition. Those are just easy ways to understand, to me, the difference between pro-social forces when it comes to religion and those that are not. If you think you have every answer and you're acting on that certainty, there's a very little chance you're going to enter a democratic public square thinking that you want to negotiate and dialogue with those who are different than you, those who are Hindu, Muslim, agnostic, atheist, secular, Reformed Jews, conservative Jews, whoever it may be. And so I never, ever want anyone to take anything I say as I'm just unilaterally against Christianity or religion. I have no interest in that position.
Brad, we're gonna have to. We're gonna have
but
to.
I am in. Yeah,
we're gonna have to end here. I hate it because we could go another hour. But Brad Onishi, co-host of the Straight Aware White American Jesus podcast, I really recommend spending some time with it. It's really terrific. The book is Preparing for War: The Extremist History of White Christian Nationalism and What Comes Next. Let's have a little healing from iron and wine as we end.
For all the love you left behind, you can have mine.